Welcome back. Let's have a quick look at the overheads in this setup. What I'll do is I'm going to quickly switch to just an image of the overheads that I've had to pull from my Instagram page. It's a little bit grainy because of all the filters and nonsense that I added to it, but you can see the overhead setup here. There are two U87s, which I'm kind of using as spot mics over the two kind of cymbal clusters, this crash over here, the hi-hat, and this one is obviously kind of more spot miking this ride and crash here. There's also a KM184, Neumann KM184 as a spot mic underneath the ride facing upwards, just to bring that cymbal forward in the mix should I need to. So it's not generally in the mix. It's been phase aligned using the time align plugin, but just in case there are sort of soft sections in certain songs where the ride needed to be heard more up in focus, that can be brought forward. Because Will is such a big hitter on the cymbals that, you know, the dynamic change can be quite dramatic between the soft sections and the soft ride sections. You might also notice there's, you know, quite a split between the cymbals. That's why I generally don't like a stereo pair or use a stereo pair, and I haven't done for quite some time. I tend to do a triple setup, so there's an additional microphone above here. I had a recollection of it being a 441 because I use that most commonly, but I may have been using that for other duties. That may have been on the underside of the snare, I'm not sure, or maybe it wasn't available that day. It's an SM57. That's directly above the snare, centered, and facing straight down, and then these two microphones are also measured to the center of the snare. That allows me to just pan these two, keeping the snare in the center of the image. So I can pan those two to balance out my cymbal image and create the stereo image of cymbals I want, rather than necessarily an honest stereo image of the cymbals as they sit. That doesn't always relate for me to a good stereo balance. It may be what existed, but it doesn't always necessarily mean that that's going to work in your stereo image, especially if you can hear in this chorus, Will is playing the right hand crash, which is, and you know, ride a lot more than he is this cymbal over here. So it would be there's a huge imbalance in the energy on the right hand side of the mix if you do it drum and perspective, that is. So yeah, those there's also a hi-hat mic doing a similar thing. I can't see what it is from here. It looks like an SM7B, just behind this stand, kind of facing away. Again, just supplementary, just to bring the hi-hats forward for any additional detail required, because again, there's quite a distance to the hi-hat for this overhead, so they're going to sound distant and roomy, even though these are in cardioid patterns. All right, let's have a little listen. So there's the four channels here, the hi-hat and ride spot, the overhead center, and then this channel here is the stereo Neumann U87s. There is just the time align plugin, just to keep those more accurately. Here's that pan plugin I mentioned before, that again, I was just using quite a lot of the time. I think I'd only just got it. Here's how the cymbal cluster, or the brass cluster, sound without any processing on. There's quite a lot of stick hit on that, and that can quite often add some weird information to deal with later on, so the attempt is to try and soothe that a little, soften that a little bit. I tend to buck the trend in heavier music and compress the cymbals. A lot of people think that compressing cymbals is a bad way to work. I don't. I think it adds an extension to the cymbals. It allows me to lift them above the guitars and help to separate the high frequency detail in the guitars and the high frequency energy in the cymbals. The cymbals can tend to wash out and numb guitars up quite a lot. There's a saturation plugin again, similar crossover points that I've mentioned before. It's on all of these, even on the toms here. You'll see they're all in the same crossover points. This is what this overhead one sounds like. So I'm exciting the high frequency energy again and trying to diminish a little bit some of the low weight and resonant weight of the cymbals. It's quite, they're nice cymbals, they're nice big cymbals, and the ride is quite crashy ride. But yeah, I'm just trying to extend those out, extend the high frequencies with this, again, tape style setup where the high frequencies are driven more and the drive diminishes as you move down the frequency spectrum. And then adding this amazing soothe plugin again, which is great for taking some of that resonant harshness out of cymbals and allowing you to push them more into the mix, especially more into compressors later on. It's a subtle thing that sounds much more effective once you're compressing, especially at the rate I am. I'm adding this PsyQ, which is a great analog modeled EQ, Siemens EQ. I forget the number, but it is fantastic at adding top end and sheen. So and then that again is being pushed. I'm boosting the highs so that this compressor responds to the high frequencies before it responds and bounces off of the low energy, even though that is not as powerful as the high energy in that signal. Here's a UAD model of a Fairchild compressor. It's actually captured this where I'm compressing it to. I am compressing this hard. I want to even these out so I have got this much more thin dynamic that I can place in the mix exactly where I want to. This is what I'm doing to the overheads. I'm just taking some of the kind of random element out of the strike hits. Obviously, cymbals move around, especially when they're being hit hard, and every strike isn't as even as it possibly might be from a sample, for example. So the cymbal is moving, and as the drummer comes to strike it, it's in a slightly different position. Sometimes it's sort of shanked more, and sometimes it's the tip of the stick. So that energy I've tried to even out with this compressor. It's also taking some of the strike rhythm, some of the strike energy out of it. So it's becoming much more of a wash, which is what I wanted in this instance. Then there's another hardware insert. This one has got a mid-side EQ, boutique 500 series mid-side EQ from a company called TK Audio. It's a Baxendale EQ, so the curves are very wide and smooth. It's just got a low, mid and high with a set of filters at the bottom. So this is adding, now that I've controlled that punch from the cymbals, I'm now trying to add a little bit of that tone back in with this. So this is the difference between these two sounds. Bear with me one second. So this is the cymbals first without this hardware insert, and this is with the hardware insert. So the mid-side EQ is dragging some of that energy out wide and some of the sheen out wide also. Okay, cool. That is it for overheads. There's only one other little thing on here, which I'm going to come back to later on. This is a feed which allows me to parallel out of the parallel processing and the drum bus processing. I'll explain that a little later on, right at the end of this drum section. But yeah, we'll come back to that in a bit. That is it for now for overheads. We'll be back to talk.